You are the God who reconciles the wayward heart through Christ. The old has gone, the new has come. We are reconciled by love. We are reconciled by love. You are the God who reconciles the wayward heart through Christ. The old has gone, the new has come. We are reconciled by love. We are reconciled by love.
Church. Yeah, good morning. See,
good morning.
Some of us are all suffering with a lot of colds this week. A lot of people up here. So that means everybody out here, you know, even though you're suffering with that little bit of cold too, we all got to put all our voices together to sing praises to our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior. So let's stand up with our opening praise songs. Battle through the hacking, coughing, dryness. You know, we don't need to get too descriptive. So, what does it mean to be saved? Say so.
What does it mean to be saved? Isn't it more than just a prayer to pray? More than just a way to heaven? What does it mean to be formed in his likeness, when we have a purpose to be salt and light in the world, in the world, to be salt and light in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so.
church would arise, oh, that we would see with Jesus' eyes, we could show the world heaven. Show what it means to be His, to be formed in His likeness, show them they have a purpose. Be salt and light in the world, to be salt and light in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so. I am redeemed, I am redeemed, I am redeemed. Salt and light in the world, to be salt and light in the world. To be salt and light in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world, in the world. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord rise up. Rise up, rise up. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so, say so.
As we all say so. Our next song, God of Brilliant Lights. This is one of those ones that if you got a real high voice, it's great because it's really up there. If you don't have a real high voice, you can sing here with me because we'll just sing it in the basement. We'll let those sopranos sing it up high. God of Brilliant Lights.
Sing it out, shout it loud, cover all the earth. Let the sound of the saints everywhere be heard. Praise the God who has come to cure every broken heart. He is Lord over all, His reign will never end. Through the fire and the flood, He draws His children in. He's the light of the world, brighter than the brightest star. The God of brilliant lights is shining down over us, breaking through the darkness, covering all the earth. Oh, 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 His love is like an ocean. Oh, 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 forever overflowing. The God of brilliant lights is shining over us. Sinners, come to the cross and lay troubles down at the foot of the one whose mercy will abound. He's not afraid of our filth, He will never turn away. The God of brilliant lights is shining down over us, breaking through the darkness, covering all the earth. Your light is shining, shining.
You may be seated. Welcome to Big Beaver United Methodist Church. If this is your first or second time here, I hope you're considering making this your church home. If this is already your church home, then I hope you'll look around and see if there are faces that are new to you, or people that you haven't seen in a while, and that you'll make a special effort to do your part to help everyone here feel welcome this morning. We have a number of announcements. They are in the bulletin. They are on inserts. You had a chance to watch them scroll by before the service. I hope you'll look them over at your leisure and take note of the ones that might impact your schedule. If there is a mission or ministry or activity that you'd like to know more about, if you find this one-stop sign-up sheet and provide your contact information and indicate which ministry it is you're interested in, we'll get you connected with the right people so that you can take a more active part in the life of our church. If it's not one of the ones listed there, then feel free to just write it in. Let's take a few moments now to greet our friends, neighbors, and visitors.
Shine like stars in the universe, holding out your truth in the darkest place. We'll be living for your glory. Jesus will be living for your glory. We'll burn so bright with your praise, O God, and declare your light to this broken world. We'll be living for your glory. Jesus will be living for your glory. We have seen the rising sun awakening the early dawn, and we're rising up to give you praise. But we have seen stars and moons, see how they shine for you, and you're calling us to do the same. So we rise up with a song, and we rise up with a cry, and we're giving you our lives. We will shine like stars in the holding out your truth in the darkest place. We'll be living for your glory. Jesus will be living for your glory. We will burn so bright with your praise, O God, and declare your light to this broken world. We'll be living for your glory. Jesus will be living for your glory.
Amen. Please be seated.
Let's take a few moments to prepare our hearts and minds for worship by spending that time in meditation and preparation.
Amen. This morning's scripture reading comes from Isaiah 58, 6 through 9a. Is not this the fast that I chose? To loose the bonds of injustice? To undo the thongs of the yoke? To let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." This is the word of the God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Come up front. You can sit there. Good morning. You all psyched up for the Super Bowl? I know you are. Are you? Who's going to win? The New England Patriots. All right, well, we'll see. Somebody's going to win. Our story today isn't about football. Have you ever been to Hawaii? All right. Well, there's a big mountain on one of the islands, Maui. It's called Haleakala. And it's very, very high. It's like, I don't know, 10,000 feet. It's up above the clouds. And to get there, you have to drive up this long, winding road that gets you up there. Our story today is about a man who went up Mount Haleakala. He drove up there. And at the top, they have some viewing stations and places you can walk around and all kinds of places to take pictures. There's a crater over one side. And on a clear day, you can see over to the next island and see the peaks on that island, too. He spent a long time up there. Actually, he was there to watch the sunset. It was dark when he went to leave. There were lots of lights in the parking lot, but when he pulled out of the parking lot, it was dark. And he thought about that long, winding road all the way down the mountainside. He started to be afraid because it wasn't familiar to him. Now it was dark. But as soon as he pulled out onto the road, something happened. There, in the middle of the road and along the edges were reflectors. And he could drive in between the reflectors all the way down the twisty, windy, long road down to the bottom of the mountain. He didn't have to worry at all. He hadn't seen those reflectors when the sun was out. And they wouldn't have been any good in the dark if he didn't have his headlights on, shining on them. But without them, it would have been a scary ride down the side of the mountain. One day, Jesus told his followers that they were the light of the world. He didn't mean that they had their own light. He meant that they were supposed to reflect the light of his love into the world. to be reflectors of God's love and to guide people into a relationship with God through Jesus. That's our job, to be reflectors. Not to shine our own lights, but to reflect the light of God's love. If we're reflecting God's love in the world, we'll have a good week no matter who wins the Super Bowl. Let's pray. God, thank you for the light of your love. Thank you for sending Jesus to show us the light of your love. And thank you for every opportunity to reflect that light into our world, into the lives of the people we know. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming up. In light of all that God has given us, all that God has done for us, we are motivated and prompted to give in return. Now is our opportunity. Let's give generously. Would the ushers please wait on us?
So it was like 50 years ago. I went to my mom one day and I said, "Hey, I don't think I'm going to make it till I'm 21. She says, "Why not?" I says, "Well, there's just all these things going on and I keep breaking pieces and things happen." So I hit 21 and I did everything I could to keep my wisdom teeth. They wanted to pull them out. You know, that was what they did back then. But at 21, I never thought it would be like this today. So I'm like, what's going on with me? I'm getting older. A couple of heart attacks later, a type 2 diabetes, an extra 100 pounds since I was 21. I don't know. One of the things that I've lost was my hearing. It was going very rapidly. So at the end of the year, I broke down and bought some hearing aids. So this is the first time I've been back to sing with you since I got hearing aids. I've only had them a month. It'll be interesting to see how well this works this morning. So far, I'm not hearing any squealing, so that's a good thing. I also had a couple of teeth pulled yesterday, by the way. They pulled one of my wisdom teeth. After all of that fighting back when I was 21, they got it anyway. I want to share a song with you this morning. If you know it, join in, no problem. But I want to give you a song that you can take home with you today and this afternoon about 3 o'clock before the football game, you're sitting there saying, that song's all right. Or on Thursday afternoon, you're sitting there at the desk and you're working away and you got that little tune that keeps popping in your head. And it goes a little bit like this. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Join in. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though I may wander, I still will follow. Cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. Ooh, yeah, that's nice. Go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No, none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? No turning back, no turning back. Thank you.
Thank you, Keith. At this point in the service, we go to our joys and concerns. We each have both in our lives. Some we share with others, some we keep to ourselves, but they're close to our hearts. Rest assured that God is aware of them, already acting to meet the needs expressed in our concerns, and to deepen our celebration of the joys in life as we recognize God as their source. Let's pray. God, thank you for the warmth of your love in the midst of the coldness of winter. We thank you for all the ways you've been with us through this week, for bringing us safely together this morning. We thank you for this church and this church family, our time together. And we remember your promise to join us when we gather in your name, and pray that you'll help us to sense your presence with us here and now. We thank you for every reminder of your powerful presence in our lives and in our world, for successful surgery and good recuperation, for safe deliveries of healthy babies, for safe travel and opportunities to spend time with family and friends. We thank you for everything good in life. We're especially grateful that you promised to be with us in the midst of uncertainty and disappointment, disagreement, in the wake of a difficult diagnosis for ourselves or a loved one, and in the face of death. We pray for those who are struggling today, who can't see or feel any evidence of your presence and activity in the circumstances of their lives. Help them to believe that you're with them, even when they feel alone or abandoned or forgotten. Give them strength and grace and hope. Help them through. We thank you for your blessings, for us as individuals and families and as a church family. We pray for your guidance. Help us to use those blessings in ways that will touch and bless the lives of others, as we strive each day to follow a little more closely the example of Jesus Christ, who taught us this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our gospel lesson today is from Matthew's gospel. Chapter 5, it's more of the Sermon on the Mount. It begins with verse 13. Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Thus ends the reading of the word. Today we have a special treat. Lois is going to come up and talk about Heifer International.
Church of the Brethren, when I first began hearing about HPI. For that is the denomination in which it began. In 1937, Dan West went to Spain as a volunteer under the sponsorship of the Friends Service Committee to help the starving children during their Civil War. As he passed out cups of powdered milk, the lines only became longer and the supply of milk less. He became discouraged, but then he started dreaming. Not a cup, but a cow, and Heifer Project was born. The beginning was a shipment of 18 heifers to Puerto Rico in 1944. Did you think it was only cows, chicks, or even goats? No way! HPI has provided dairy and beef cattle, goats, sheep, pigs, rabbits, fish, honeybees, poultry, drafted dairy buffalo, camels, yaks, and alligators to over 110 countries and 33 U.S. states by 1990, and the list goes on. During a 9 to 12 month period, recipients learn by hands-on experience how to care for their animals. Groups are formed, and they must organize themselves so that they can function together. They are taught human hygiene and nutrition. Participants must give one of their animal's first offspring to a neighbor and share their new skills. Sharing what one has received removes the stigma of charity and instead fosters friendship, dignity, and hope. I had a friend, Don Meyer, of Kokomo, Indiana, who was a volunteer for HPI. He felt privileged to help deliver animals. He was also a willing speaker. Listen to Don's story in his own words. In 1988, when a Manchester, Indiana man donated bees to HPI, I had the opportunity to help deliver 40 hives to Kentucky. This trip required all-night driving because bees must be moved while they are asleep. This trip resulted in going 39 hours without sleep and a few bee stings. When I visited our projects in Bolivia, South America, I was impressed by the beauty of the snow-capped mountains and the gorgeous scenery. But when I visited the valleys where the people lived, I was also impressed by the extreme poverty and harsh conditions in some areas. Why and how can rabbits bring hope to these American women? Some areas are barren, dry, and windswept land. The infant mortality rate is high, and many children are malnourished. Most of the husbands and youth seek employment off the farms during the week and return on weekends. The women and children are left to care for the crops and the few acres owned. Therefore, it is important to have means to improve their esteem through these rabbit projects. As a group receives their classes, over approximately a 6-month period, they began to build a small rabbitry to house 10 adult rabbits, 8 female and 2 male, and up to 100 offspring. During this 9 to 12 month period, they learn by hands-on experience how to care for these animals. These people live on the Altiplano, 12,000 feet above sea level. When Don and his group visited, the women had made several articles of clothing from the hides they had cured themselves. The manure was used in their vegetable gardens, a direct result of their nutrition classes. And of course, the rabbits were food. When Don talked to one of these women through an interpreter, she expressed heartfelt thanks for the training. Now we have tomatoes, carrots, green beans, and other vegetables. Before, we only had onions. This makes a great difference in their lives and brings hope for the future. After a disaster in Cameroon, North Africa, on August the 21st, 1986, when a carbon dioxide gas erupted from a crater lake, killing all of the cattle and most of the 1,700 people living there, for those remaining, all hope of survival was gone. HPI was there with 10 crossbreed cattle and their classes. Alligators were given to Indian tribes without tribal status. Hides were made into leather, and meat was sold. HPI helped build ponds and gave money to begin. After 3 years, a percentage of the profit must be returned to HPI. Or how about heifers to Poland, pigs to Thailand or leucania trees to semi-tropical areas. These grow fast and have many uses. They even gather nitrogen from the air and deposit it in the ground, thus fertilizing themselves. And just as it has since 1944, because of the many volunteers and our donations, along with all the other donations, the work goes on and on and on. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Lois. Lois's talk provides an illustration for what Jesus was talking about when he told us that we were the light of the world, reflections of the light of God's love in the world as we touch the lives of those in need, near and far. In today's Old Testament lesson, Isaiah begins by pointing out that the Israelites seem to be just going through the motions of worship. They seem to think that's good enough. It's enough to make them feel righteous. But Isaiah doesn't mince words in telling them that true worship is not accomplished in an hour a week or on one day a week. True worship, worship that brings us into the right relationship with God, finds expression in how we live all week long, the things we say and do each day. True worship finds expression in acts of kindness and charity. It works to free the oppressed and those who are suffering in bondage, sharing your bread with the hungry, offering shelter to the homeless, clothing the naked. Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard, Isaiah promised. True worship is not about us or what we get out of it. It inspires us, opens our eyes, our hearts, and our wallets to help others to the glory of God. One of my former district superintendents said he used to cringe when he asked people why they attended a particular church, and they told him, because they're friendly. He said, if all you're looking for are friendly people, you can find them at the country club or the YMCA. His point was that the one thing the church offers exclusively is Jesus Christ. A closer walk, a deeper relationship with Jesus is the best thing the church has to offer. It seems Jesus was saying much the same thing when he said, you are the light of the world. Question is, are we letting our light shine? There are people in our world, in our everyday lives, who are wandering in darkness, who are looking for a light to guide them to spiritual, emotional, and mental safety. Could our church light the way for them? Could you help them find their way? As Christ's followers, we are the light of the world. We have what the world so desperately needs. We're not the source of that light. We merely reflect God's light, revealed in and through Jesus Christ. Near the end of a special Saturday evening worship service, a thunderstorm unleashed a bolt of lightning that struck a transformer, plunging the church and the entire town into total darkness. Someone found their way to the sacristy and located enough candles to pass out to the congregation. They lit their candles much like we do on Christmas Eve, each person sharing their light with the person next to them. The congregation made their way through the church and outside the main entrance. The rain was still coming down in sheets. Looking around, they could see that the whole town was in darkness. One of them later wrote, "There we stood, a little band of Christians, each clutching a light, not sure whether to venture out into the storm or stay inside the church in hopes that the storm would soon blow over." He went on to write, "It occurred to me then that this is the temptation I face every day. It's easy to play it safe and be a good Christian in church. It's much harder to venture out in faith, to be the light of the world, carrying that light into the storms of life." Today, as we participate in the sacrament of Holy Communion, as we are reminded of the moment when the light of God's love shone brightest, may our lights be rekindled. As we leave the church and go our separate ways, may we intentionally reflect the light of God's love into the lives we touch from day to day, allowing it to shine on us, in us, and through us into the dark places in our world. Let it be so. Amen. The communion service begins on page 13, or you can follow it on the screen. We'll start with the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of a new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Would the communion stewards please come forward? I'll do the bread, and then if two of you will take the cups, and then one of you can do them. All right, you could do that. Do you want to do this? Okay. Body of Christ. Thank you.
For you are salt and light, you are love's great height.
You are deep and wide,
a consuming fire.
You are salt and light,
you are love's great height.
You are deep and wide,
a consuming fire. Let my eyes see your kingdom shine all around. Let my heart overflow with passion for your name. Let my life be a song revealing who you are. Your salt and light. You are salt and light.
You are salt and light.
You are salt and
reminded of the light of God's love, determined to be a source of that light by letting your light shine wherever you go. May the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with us, abide within us, and act through us, now and forever. Amen. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good to see you.